You heard Ajay Mathur, who was the Indian negotiator on technology. And you had spoken yesterday, three days ago, and you spoke about cluster energy decentralized options. And you have got very strong views of how they need to be mainstreamized and whether we have to... I will then pass on to Willy, because Ajay Mathur is very clearly opening the ground for the corporates to enter into this field. Say that.
Sorry, John, I didn't precisely. Could you summarize what Ajay Mathur was saying earlier? I couldn't hear him properly.
What Ajay Mathur was saying was that the technology needs to be upscaled. So that, and then thereby interpreting it as if the private sector is the only sector which will be able to absorb that kind of scale, right? Because then if the public sector comes into it or the government comes into it, it becomes inefficient, it has corruption, it has XYZ kind of stuff. Also, today, nowadays, we are told that the private sector is the one that has the investment.
This is a demonstration.
And we just saw in the previous episode also, when we had this whole debate on the finance mechanism, and on one side there is a move to say that the financing has to come from public sources, okay, and that seems to be acceptable, but the offtake of that finance is going to be through this type of mechanism which will actually fund private ventures.
This is a demonstration of Wirecast.
Yeah. Over to you, Siddharth.
Hello. So what's the question then?
If you can just give a brief, then I can play your film. And tell us, my question to you is the same question I asked. When you were doing, cluster energy in rural area, how is that going to be upscaled? And you have some practical problems and you have some political issues.
That's right. Now, in the kind of projects that we are involved, which is basically decentralized energy, at the very local level of grassroots. Now, these kinds of projects so far have been essentially promoted by, overseas development assistance or private aid through donor agencies. And these reach out to a very, very small segment, maybe 5 villages, 10 villages, maximum maybe 15, 20. And therefore, the outreach, they're basically islands of technology innovation, as you would call it, right? Now, the trouble, obviously, is in how does one take it to the next level? Now, private finance, my personal experience with that is that it at this point in time, is not affordable for the community. I mean, the community basically cannot afford to pay 2,000, 3,000 rupees for solar technology by itself. I mean, even if it's just one solar lantern, I mean, that's not possible. On the other hand, the electricity that we use at home for light and so on is subsidized already. So the government says that they cannot provide alternative technology or renewable technology without private or without it being at cost. And it has to sort of compete with the market. But the energy that we receive by itself does not compete with the market. So I think there is a contradiction in terms. So there is a problem already there. Now, in terms of how do we see it upscaling, obviously the government has to lay emphasis on this. And at this point in time, the emphasis is still from non-renewable energy sources, and which is basically coal. Even now, the perception is that tomorrow, let me try and put this in a bit of a scale perspective. Now, India consumes as much electricity in total volume well, as much as Germany in 2004, and Germany and France. Okay, now we are 1.2 billion people, and they are 80 million people. I mean, it's a scale of 1:10 or 1:11, which means that in the future, if electricity has to reach every one of us, okay, which right now is about 50-odd%, it would actually mean that at the scale of the way, say, Germany or France consumes energy, it would basically the whole, I mean, it is as much electricity as the whole world consumes today. So it's, and if it is produced from coal, then we might as well, you know, kiss the world or Earth goodbye. I mean, that it's not going to work. So right now, the government or anybody looking at scaling up energy has to look at renewable resources, and the and this excuse that renewable resources can only come from the market is not correct, because already the non-renewable sources are subsidized by itself. So there is a problem in terms, and this is so the question of then how does one upscale it is essentially to do with, well, political will, definitely, and I think that government spending is the first priority there. The second is in looking at small scale, you know, capital being put into the community so that they can by themselves, at least now, you know, look at energy through solar lanterns or some or small, you know, sort of interventions as an entrepreneurial model. And third is in a way what we are trying to do by raising resources from abroad through overseas development. And finally, and I think that the least, well, the most viable, but at the same time, an option that perhaps we have to deal with is the carbon markets, which is what we are sort of also relating to. So these are the options right now.
Really, any John? Yeah. Any comments on the whole technology transfer issue? Yesterday you were talking about who is going to get that technology transfer agency. Willie.
John, you're talking to me or someone else?
The technology transfer issue. Willie, by the way, is the coordinator of the climate justice campaign in India.
No, I would like to first comment on what you said. See, what is happening in Durban is that the U.S. Is trying to push the private corporates into the climate fund. So the Green Climate Fund is going to is being envisaged as a green corporate fund or a greedy corporate fund. And the banks will be involved. And we have already seen the mess of the banks in the last 2-3 years in US and all over Europe. But still you see that the US is pushing this, and there is very little resistance on this in the COP, except from the ALBA countries, that is Bolivia, Venezuela, and the ALBA nations. Whereas the others look like they are not bothered about it. And also the whole fund is going to be managed by the World Bank. Earlier there was some opposition in Cancun, but right now there's not much opposition, except for these few countries. Even in the civil society, we see like organizations like CAN and all supporting this position. I mean, they are okay with corporate sector, okay with the private companies coming in, which means a lot, because once these people come in, then you know what a mess they can create. And they'll only come for profits. They'll not come to solve the climate crisis at all. And as far as technology is concerned, one of the major stumbling blocks still is the IPR issue, because they still need to sort it out. And there has still not been any clear understanding on how the intellectual property rights on technology can be sorted out. But among many countries, there is some understanding. But then US is US. And they blocked the Kyoto Protocol. They never signed it, and they created a mess last time. And this time also they're creating a big mess. And they will end up doing nothing and not allow anybody else to do anything. So it's in a bad scenario. So what we are going to witness may be a new climate regime. That's what the US and the other countries want. They want to get out of the 17 years of negotiation and get out of whatever they made the commitments in Bali, would call it the Bali roadmap, and create a new climate regime where the rich nations will only pledge, they will decide voluntarily what they want to do, how much they want to contribute, how much they want to reduce their emissions, and they will force some of the developing countries to follow suit, especially India and China, maybe Brazil and South Africa, to have much higher standards as compared to them. And this will also, the new regime will also mean many more, much more influence of the market, involvement of the markets in this whole business, which was never there before. So that's the scene here.